Shado and her small group also have been organizing, are organizing this clothing drive for Sharon Willows, and realizing they've done some really neat visits to different people. And they've realized, too, that a lot of people that are in these homes kind of seem to be forgotten. And she, that really worked on her heart. And so now they're asking for donations. Some of you have already done it. There are boxes in the gallery, so you can put there. Here's the description in the center about all that as well. Those are the two highlighted announcements. Is there any other announcements before we get started? Our opening song is Holy Spirit Come, kind of brings us into the heart of worship, asking the Holy Spirit to fill our hearts. So with that, we'll go ahead and get started.
Holy Spirit.
And one of those words that has no time limit or season, Emmanuel, God with us. And he's here in this place now. And no matter what comes our way, we know that God is already ahead of it, sees the victory, sees the final outcome. And that's what's behind this next song, The Battle Belongs. Now, what was that we were saying, Tom? We were talking about moving into, what is that? Moving on our knees? What is that? Praying on our knees? Remember that phrase?
Well, he asked me about walking through this process. I said, I'm going to do it on my knees.
I'm going to walk through the process on my knees. Yeah, I love that. I love that. That's what we do. Let's begin our service. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we thank you, Father, for this time together. We thank you for the opportunity to hear your word and to praise your name, to present our offerings to you, our thoughts, our requests, and also our very selves. Lord, I ask that you would bless each person here so that the words that are said today magnify your name and impact their lives for your kingdom. In Jesus' precious name, amen. There's a really cool phrase, and it's been done in song, it's been done in poetry, it's even been done in what they call inspirational reading. It starts out with these words that you see up front. Oh Lord, I love the habitation of your heart, your house, and the place where your glory dwells. And that just resounds and resonates with me. I love the habitation of your house, and the place where your glory dwells. God says, where my word is, I will be there. Where two or three people are gathered together in my name, I'm going to be here. And we know from stories from Solomon, we know that the glory of God filled the temple. And God is here in this place. Amen. And I know that he's promised that he's going to watch over us and protect us. The psalm goes on and says, vindicate me, O Lord, for I have walked in my integrity in iniquity, and I have trusted not in the way that I should. And when we trust in something that we're not supposed to trust in, we have no place to turn, either within ourselves or outward. We have to turn to the Lord. And we have to say, Lord, I love the habitation of your house and the place where your glory dwells. I'm in this place now, and I want to be right with you. And I want to claim the atonement and the sacrifice and the wonderful gift of grace that your Son won for me on the cross. And so that's what we're going to do next. You know, we do that every Sunday. Maybe you're thinking to yourself, why do we do it every Sunday? Well, I'm going to do it every day, let alone every Sunday. But we go before God and we realize that he's going to respond with his grace. The times when we haven't forgiven others like we're supposed to, the times when we've done something we're not supposed to. So for thought, word, and deed, we're going to go to him now, and we're going to confess our sins to God. We're going to confess our inabilities to do what he's called us to do. We're going to confess our wavering of faith, and I'm going to be using different words to help you along the way. And this is your confession. But just so you know, the person next to you is doing the same thing. So as a body of believers, we're confessing. That's part of the fellowship. Confessing the name of Jesus, confessing our sins, and receiving forgiveness. So let's pray. Prayer of confession. Father God, when we turn to your word, we can be filled with awe. We can be filled with just the astounding fact that you're communicating to us and you're showing yourself to us in your word. You've given us blessing upon blessing. You've also given us guidelines because you love us so much. Guidelines like loving you above all things and holding your name sacred, coming to your place of worship and being part of the family of faith by remembering the Sabbath, keeping it set apart and holy to your name, honoring our parents and others in authority, honoring and respecting life, leading a life that's chaste and decent and focuses on the purity, not on the other things that this world wants to disguise as good. Respecting others' property, others' names, and not desiring something that's not ours. Hear us, O Lord, as we confess our sins, for we are sorry that we have sinned against you and others, for the sins of selfishness and pride. We ask for forgiveness for the sin of looking to ourselves before we look to you. We ask for forgiveness. We haven't walked in your faithfulness. We've turned away from you instead of turning towards you. We ask your forgiveness. For our love that isn't genuine, we haven't taken the good you've given us and overcome evil. We ask your forgiveness and we ask for your mercy. You've taught to us and you've commanded us to share the good news to others, and we've held it to ourselves. For that, we ask your forgiveness. Lord, I ask now that you would hear my brothers and sisters in Christ as they remember and know certain particular things that they've done or haven't done this week and continue to go against your word. Hear them now, their words of confession, as they silently lay those at the foot of the cross. So, Father, remove our transgressions from us so that we can live as those who have been called by your name and delight in your goodness, that Christ lives within us. Amen.
Amen.
When Jesus says, I am with you to save you and deliver you, those are his words, declares the Lord. And through Jesus Christ, crucified, risen, and coming again, you have been declared that you are no longer enemies, delivered from your enemy, the sin and death and the devil. His steadfast love is yours. As a called pastor commissioned by Jesus Christ to be able to speak this wonderful word, your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, that God's people said,
Amen.
We're going to celebrate it with a song saying, Hello, my name is, and then maybe we'll have a chance to share God's peace after the song.
Oh,
let's go ahead and share the joy that we are children of the one true King with one another as we share God's peace together. Perfect. Maybe there's people in this place that would say, boy, they've just been getting one hard knock after the other. And I want you to know, you're not alone. Okay, there's stuff going on in this world that's pushing back hard, and let alone all of the situations that come our way. Jeremiah was a prophet in the Old Testament, and this particular section from Jeremiah 15 kind of shows two parts. And I think you've been given a handout, so you should have that in front of you, or you can go into your Bibles that are in the pews if you want to follow along word for word. In the blue Bible, it's 547. The black one, it's 602. But I like this passage because it shows both sides. It shows Jeremiah really going through a rough time, and you can almost reflect on what it was. And then it shows how God responds. And since today is the final in the sermon series where we see the world pushing back against the church, pushing hard against God's word over and over again, in fact, we talked about the world being an enemy of God's as far as the flesh and that kind of thing, we really need a place where we can say, well, I need something to be able to stand on, some kind of a firm foundation. And I think in Jeremiah, you're going to hear a little bit of it. Oh, Lord, you know. Remember me and visit me and take vengeance for me on my persecutors. So you can see he's angry. It says, in your forbearance, take me not away. Know that for your sake, I bear reproach. Your words were found and I ate them. Your word became to me a joy and delight of my heart. For I am called by your name, O Lord of hosts. And then he goes on from wanting his people and those people that were persecuting him have vengeance upon him. Now he starts to move and says, look, I have not sat in company with revelers, nor did I rejoice. I sat alone because your hand was upon me, for you filled me with indignation. And then he goes on to say, why is my pain increasing, my wound incurable, refusing to be healed? Will you be to me like a deceitful brook, like waters that fail? I especially resonate with the I sat alone because your hand was upon me. Maybe you've felt alone when you've been following God's word, or at least in your heart, you're doing what God wants you to do, and then you're struck with that stark difference between what the world is doing and what you're doing, and you feel like, man, you're on an island. I can only imagine Jeremiah thinking that as well. And now he's questioning whether or not God is going to just be like a deceitful brook, saying, I'm there, but I'm not really. And then he gets the answer. Therefore, thus says the Lord, if you return, I will restore you, and you shall stand before me. If you utter what is precious in my precious and not what is worthless, you shall be as my mouth. They shall turn to you, but you won't turn to them. And I will make you to this people a fortified wall of bronze. They'll fight against you, but they will not prevail over you. For I am with you to save you and deliver you, declares the Lord. I will deliver you out of the hand of the wicked, and I will redeem you from the grasp of the ruthless. So as you're thinking about taking a stand, as you're hearing today's message, which is hopefully going to permeate your heart and motivate you to go, I am going to take a stand. I am going to stand firm for the Lord. And I am going to use words when necessary, because sometimes my actions may be disguised as just any old person doing any old thing. Know that God is going to stand by you, and he will help you prevail. That's what we believe. We know the world can be harsh, but I believe in God, Father, Son, and Spirit. I know you do too. Let's stand. And we're going to declare our faith now, singing the song, We Believe, especially in this time of desperation.
We
seated. If there are any children that want to come up for a children's message, I am ready for you guys. How you guys doing? Oh, great. I got someone with me. You know who this is?
Is it a nutcracker?
It is a nutcracker. Guys, yeah, normally this is around Christmas time, but this is a very special nutcracker. This is what's supposed to look like Martin Luther. Yeah, you want to come and visit him? You can come to my study, my office, and you'll see him in there. He keeps me company every now and then. Martin Luther was a very special man that had a very special calling on his life, but it wasn't easy. It wasn't easy at all because he found out something about the Bible and about Jesus that went against the people who had all the power and the people who were in charge. And then he had a choice to make. And the choice was to go ahead and go along with what they said or not. What do you think he did? He did not. Okay. All right, so you guys have school starting now? You guys got going on? Yeah? Yeah? And there are probably, how many, you got a bunch of kids in your classroom, right? Yeah. And I'm willing to bet that since you know who Jesus is, but not everyone knows who Jesus is, I'm willing to bet in your classroom there isn't. And there's going to be times in your classroom that something's going to happen and you're going to think, oh, I can't do that. That's not right. And then you're going to be left with a choice. Do I go ahead and do it? Or do I not say anything? Or do I say something? Okay. Well, in Martin Luther's case, what they were saying, the people that were in charge were saying is, the way you get to heaven is you have to be a good boy and a good girl and do a lot of stuff, a lot of good stuff, and then you're going to get to heaven because that's how you get to heaven. And he was like, But should he say something? Should he say nothing? Or should he agree with them? He didn't agree with them, you're right. Hey, that's not true. You know, that's what he did. In fact, the message for today, the theme of today is taking your stand or standing firm. And he even used those words after he said, and I'm going to share with you what he said. He goes, here I stand. I can do no other. And they said, so help me God. What he said was, the Bible is the Bible is the Bible. It's true. And Jesus died on the cross to take away our sins. And we can't do anything to get into heaven on our own. And unless you guys, he's telling them, show me that this is how it works by the Bible, and he knew they couldn't, I'm not going to take back my words. Now, he could have just gone away and not said anything. Just like in your classrooms, when someone does something that's wrong, you go, not say anything. Or you can say, no, that's not, we don't do that. That's not right. That's not how you love someone. Yeah. So it's about taking a stand, and that's what I'm hoping you guys will start to learn to do. Ask moms and dads, ask grandmas and grandpas, ask if you have brothers and sisters, if they're older, whatever, just to say, how do you guys take a stand? Because they should be showing you how to take a stand.
Oh, I want to go get another bag of chips and
All right, and for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord. We're not going to do that. I'm glad you're not going to do that, but you said so.
She didn't do it.
She knew it was wrong.
She is, like,
right? She knew it was wrong after you talked to her.
Yes.
That's the best part. So I want you to take a stand, and I'm going to have an echo prayer because we need God's help to do it. An echo prayer is I say it, then you say it. And they're going to help us, right? You guys going to help us? Okay. All right, here we go. Dear God. Help me to take a stand for you, especially when it's hard. Amen. All right. Thanks so much. You can go back. word of prayer. Almighty God, your Son endured the agony and shame of the cross. He did it to redeem his enemies and make them friends. We were at once enemies, and God, you reconciled us to yourself. I ask that you would grant each of us courage to take up our cross daily and follow our Lord Jesus wherever he leads. In the strong, precious name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Well, I got what I call a sandwich sermon, where I'm going to start out with some, hopefully, words of encouragement that I found, and because I think we need it. In this day and age, with all the stress and all the difficult times, I think we need some words of encouragement. So from Psalm 34, verse 9, it's these words: "Fear the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him lack nothing. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your ways to the Lord. Trust in him, and he will act. He will bring forth your righteousness as the light, and your justice as the noonday. Be still before the Lord, and wait patiently for him." Doesn't make sense to the world. In fact, in our Tuesday morning Bible class, we were talking about the foolishness of the gospel. And, you know, it just doesn't make any sense. The story started out with a kind of an analogy or an illustration with the story. And it just talked about how everything that we have is from God, and how foolish it is to say that Jesus Christ would save you from all of your sins. In fact, in our first message of this series, that was the big pushback from the world. You might remember, if you didn't, it'll be as clear as day. From the very beginning of time, after God created man and Eve and they fell into sin, there needed to be a Savior. Sin entered the world. And with sin came death. And so because that entered the world and sin and death entered the world, there was a need for a Savior. And so the Bible has declared very clearly that people are in need of a Savior, that they are sinners, and that they can do no good in and of themselves. Now, if you say this to someone else who doesn't know Jesus, they'll push back right away, and they'll say, "You are really off your rocker." They're going to say something like, "I know a lot of good people. I've seen them do a lot of good stuff. I've seen them help the poor. I've seen them heal people. I've seen them care for people. I've seen them go to hospitals and spend time with people. I've seen great dads and great moms and grandmas and grandpas, and I've seen great legacies being passed down. These are all really good people." So you're wrong when you say there is no good people. But the Bible says there is no one good except the one. The Bible says all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And so what people have now done, if they have a relationship with the church, they've thought of and they've come up with their own truth. And they said, "You know what, I really believe that it's okay for this to happen in my life, for this to happen in the world. People need to have this right and this right and this right." And then they go to the church, whatever church it is, and the church just, for example, speaks against it. They don't think that's right. So they say, "Well, you know what? I'm going to go to another church." And they keep going to a church and another one and another one until that church finally agrees with their truth. And they say, "Well, the church is in harmony with my truth." The fact of the matter is, when churches preach and teach the true word of God, it is going to rub up against society. And so your first blank comes out crystal clear. The true church is the church of which Jesus Christ is Lord. Now, there's a phrase that we hear all the time: Jesus Christ is Lord. But I'm just going to break it down really quickly and succinctly for you. Jesus, God saves, a name given to a Jewish boy in hopes that he would be the deliverer. And that name was given to a lot of Jewish boys in the time when Jesus was born. Jesus just happened to be the real one. Christ, atoning, or the anointed one, the Messiah in Hebrew, So Jesus is the Christ. The true church is the church of which Jesus, the Christ, is Lord. Now that's not any bigger than the other, but it seems to impact me more. Is Jesus Christ the Lord of you and of this church? And we say yes. That means he is our end-all, be-all. He is where the buck stops. He is the Word made flesh. That's Jesus Christ is Lord, and that's where our church is made up of. And people who believe that, people who acknowledge that, people who want to be part of that, well, that's who makes up the church. The true church is made up of believers who call themselves Christians. The believers only God can see. When I teach confirmation, we talk about the visible and invisible church. And some of you are going, yeah, I know that. And some of you are going, what is he talking about? Well, the visible church is what you see right now, what you hear now, what you can feel and touch now, the visible church. You can look at each other and you can just assume that everyone here is a believer. The invisible church is all believers everywhere for all time. Which means I could load these pews up, wouldn't that be something? Every these pews would be completely filled, and there just might be one or two that's not part of the invisible church. They're there. To our eyes, they're part of the visible church. But to God, he doesn't know them. They don't know him yet. And I'm glad that they would be in this place hearing. And we call themselves Christ-likes, little Christians, little Christs, followers of Jesus. And we are to live in certain ways. There's a Bible reading found in Matthew chapter 16 where Jesus is talking about people who follow. So if you're following along, it's Matthew 16, beginning at verse 21. It's again on that sheet there for you to read if you want to do it that way. And I'm going to read you the story because I want you to hear one of these great believers, Peter. He's in this story. From the time Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem, suffer many things from the elders, the chief priests, the scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised again. That's the gospel. We're all going, yeah, praise God. Peter, upon hearing this, says, he takes him aside, he begins to rebuke him, saying, far be it from you, Lord, this shall never happen to you. But he turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You're a hindrance to me, for you are not setting your mind on things of God, but on things of men. Peter only saw what his eyes saw. He didn't see the big picture that Jesus, the Christ, the Messiah, the Lord, came to deliver man and had to do this. Now, I take it, it would have been kind of a weird thing if Peter responded differently and said, help, let me help you to the cross, Jesus. That would have been a little strange. But that's what he was talking about when Jesus was saying that he had to be there, and Peter didn't want that. Then Jesus tells his disciples, if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Your life is going to be hard in this world, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. What profits anybody if he gains the whole world and yet forfeits his life? What profits you to amass all this kind of happiness here when you can't take it with you? Bible study just before this class, I'm talking about the transient things that aren't going to, you can't take it with you. You brought nothing in, you're not taking anything out. And the only thing that will have to happen here is that the Holy Spirit to ignite a saving faith in each and every one of you. Truly I say to you, he goes on to say that there are going to be people that'll see the coming of the Son of Man. And there were people seeing Jesus, his kingdom came. This is the message that we have. And the world needs to hear it, which is your next blank. But they just don't know it yet. They don't know they're lost. They think they're just fine. Life is going on. Have you ever stopped to wonder, if you could just think about a non-Christian for a moment, someone who doesn't know about the Bible, have you ever stopped to wonder if they ever felt that certain things that are going on in our country and maybe in the world were wrong? Have you ever asked the question, how do they know they're wrong? You might say, well, they have a conscience. Have you ever asked the question, where did that come from? We have an answer. The Bible says the law of God is written on man's heart. The conscience has been given. Man, because of God's law in his heart, know that it's wrong to murder. Know that it's wrong to take things that aren't theirs. Know this. The people need to hear that next thing, the message, the good news of Jesus Christ, but they don't know it yet. This foolishness that you're speaking to someone, they don't understand it. But Jesus loves you. Well, who's Jesus? Well, he died on the cross. What's a cross? I mean, you don't know how where their level of understanding is. But they're watching you and I. And they're also watching their own government and the people around them. And they're trying to decide what is truth. And we're going to get to that in a minute. In the meantime, you and I cannot be conformed to this world. We cannot be conformed to this world, which means we're not supposed to act like everybody else. As Lord said, no, we didn't get the extra bag of chips. We said it was wrong. You just don't do that. Awesome job. Exactly right. Boy, that makes you stand apart. What about that football player, the one out of the whole team in high school that stopped and prayed before every game? That set him apart. What about when we aren't conformed to this world? Because we want to fit in. Tell little boys and little girls that they're not supposed to fit into their classroom and you just might as well feel like you're working, pushing a chain up the hill. It's not going to work. Because they want to fit in. Yet we're told not to conform, especially when the world is doing things and saying things that we realize are not what God has called us. And so we know that we aren't going to be conformed to the world so that we may discern what is the will of God. Discern is the next plank. I get the question every year, many times throughout the year. Pastor, what's the will of God? What is God's will in this situation? What am I supposed to do? I don't know. What's God's will? Well, God's will is very plain. It's right there in the Bible. It's really a simple thing. It's to, when we discern what the will of God is, you're doing what God would do, what Jesus would do in this place. You're not stealing. You're not refusing to come to the Lord's Supper. You're not neglecting worship. You're not neglecting reading the Bible. God wants you to do that. Marriages are meant to last forever. Lives are meant to be conceived and born and thrive. That's the will of God. But even back in the time of the writing of the Old Testament in Proverbs, and you got that passage ready to fill in next, there is a way that seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death. Ultimately, anything outside of Jesus Christ, anything outside of God's will end up there. Outside. In the Roman passage that you have also, I think you have on that sheet, I'm going to touch on that. So how are you supposed to be not conformed? How are you supposed to live differently, like no one else in this world? Paul gives a full litmus test. In fact, mine's entitled, The Marks of a True Christian. It's what we are to do and how we are to live. It says, love be genuine. Abhor what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love, this whole passage you could preach a whole week sermon on, a 7 series. Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing our honor. Do not be slothful in zeal. Be fervent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in tribulation. Be constant in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saint and seek to show hospitality. In the Bible study called The Truth Project, I remember there was this one part about having a Christian working for them in their business. And as a Christian, they were talking about the Christians that were living like this. They were working as unto the Lord. They were doing what they were supposed to do. And the conversation, he kind of surmises, it went something like this. Yeah, how's work going? Work's going all right. The business is thriving pretty good. Hey, can I tell you what happened the other day? No, what happened the other day? I hired a Christian. You did? Man, I wish I could get me one of those. They abhor what is evil. They work as unto the Lord. They are loving one another. They don't rebuke. They don't return evil for evil. I mean, oh, I wish I had one. That's how we're not conformed to this world. We live like God is our Lord. Jesus is our Lord. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. And he goes on and on. And then he goes on. He says, you know what? Never avenge yourself. But leave that to the wrath of God. It's written, vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord. Everything do the opposite. If your enemy is hungry, feed them. If he's thirsty, give him grace or give him something to drink. By doing so, the Bible says you're heaping burning coals upon his head. I like one person said, you're heaping grace upon their head. They won't know what to do when you respond in loving kindness. And remember what we said in Jeremiah. Remember what's going to happen. You're going, man, I don't know where I'm going to find that strength. I don't know how I'm going to be able to do that. I will make you to this people a fortified wall of bronze. They will fight against you, but they shall not prevail over you. I am with you to save you and deliver you, declares the Lord. We have to focus and stay on the truth. Not as the world says, this is what relationships are, and this is what families are. This is what life is, and this is the value of life. No, it's not what the world says, it's what God says. And that truth, we know where it's found. And here's, you ready for your next blank. Truth that lasts, truth that changes us forever, is found only in the one who is the truth incarnate, Jesus of Nazareth. I had someone in my office, well, actually it wasn't in my office, he called. He was a young man, he wants to have his son baptized. And he says, hey, I really want to have my son baptized. I'm sorry I haven't gotten back to you, but I'm in this line of business and I just didn't have any free time, but I found some free time. And I'm like, okay, what happened? Well, he said, well, I'm a father, we're not married, but I believe, and I really want to have my son baptized, and the one church that we spoke to wouldn't do it. I'm like, oh, well, come and talk. He goes, what do I have to do? I said, come and talk to me. And it was just so really refreshing because what he did is he started talking to me about, he goes, I've done some research. I want to figure out what these Lutherans are all about. And he said, I'm looking for something that's like, doesn't ebb and flow, something that's kind of solid. You know, I mean, you know, right now, I mean, there's God's word. What do you guys think of God's word? I was able to tell him. What do you think of this idea of, you know, what happens in baptism? I said, God comes to you, the Holy Spirit comes to you, it's the Word of God that makes it happen. He goes, okay, well, what about other things? And he was asking me all these questions, and I was just loving it because it was obvious that he wanted not an ebb and flow church, not one that goes with the flow. He wanted a foundation to stand on. He wanted something solid. And I'm looking forward to meeting him this next week. I don't see him here today. I wouldn't know if he was here because I don't know his face. But he said he was going to come in and visit. I'm looking forward to that. It's only found in the truth incarnate, Jesus of Nazareth. And so there, that's what he wants. So this church will continue to teach the biblical standards with the hopes of helping all people see the blessings and benefits of living in God's laws. God's laws that have been given by through God's grace. Love me and honor me and I will repay you, respond to you. Put me first. Seek first the kingdom of God. Everything else will be taken care of. God's promised over and over again. Test me and see, he says. You're going to have an opportunity to go against the world. The world is always happening, but you're going to have to use words. Because I know I can see someone giving, you know, a huge check to a hospital or another person getting a huge check at a hospital. And by the outside, we won't know who's who and what's what. We both say they're good things. The thing is, only God knows who's doing it in his name, who put him first, who's Lord of his life. And what matters is what God knows. Just like Abel's fragrant offering. And we need to tell people. And how are they going to hear? Unless someone tells them. And how is someone going to tell them unless they themselves have been told? And how are they going to do it unless they've been sent? Blessed are those who are sent, and you are sent. Each one of you is sent to your place, your vocation, your family, your work, your atmosphere, whether it's in the work or whether it's in the play, whether it's in the office or on the golf course, you're there for a reason. To let everyone know the Lord is the Lord of your life. So I call these power verses that are there. You may want to take them off and put them on your refrigerator. I don't know what you want to do. Just remind me. I wanted something there for you to go, man, when I take a stand, where do I turn? Put on the full armor of God so that when the days of evil come, you may be able to stand your ground against the evil schemes of the devil. Can you imagine that? You got the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit. You're shod with gospel, and you got the belt of truth girding your ones. You're all taken care of. So put on that armor of God so when the evil days come, you'll be able to stand your ground after everything you've tried. I love this one from Peter. Peter's the one that kind of messed up, but then he certainly responded. Peter's saying, resist him, that is the devil, firm in your faith, knowing that the same experiences of suffering are being accomplished by your brethren who are in the world. You're not alone. Be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, Corinthians. Conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel, so that whether I come and see you or remain absent, I will hear of you that where you are standing firm in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for faith in the gospel. That's Paul talking to them. Wouldn't it be amazing if someone said, I heard about you. I heard about St. Peter's. You're talking about the love and joy of Jesus. You're talking about God's grace. You're talking about forgiveness. You're talking about strength. You're talking about solid foundation. I'm like, yeah, that's my church. Yeah, that's you. Therefore, my beloved brethren, whom I long to see, my joy and crown, in this way stand firm in the Lord. And then that wonderful one from Proverbs. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. Standing firm, though the world pushes back. I pray God's blessings on you, your life, and really, the whole church. The whole invisible church. To God be the glory. Amen.
Amen.
I'm ready to go on out there. Howard Christian Soldiers. We have a time for our offering next. These are some passages that I said earlier. I thought they were earlier on in the outline. So Mark, I already went through this those passages. We're going to go ahead and do the offering next, and I'll have that up here. I'm also here for prayers if you'd like to have a prayer said over you. I think there's music on that slide. No? No? Okay. Well, you can bring your offerings up now. Your promise to hear our prayer. And Even though we may present things that are difficult for us, we know that you, our God, are so much greater. So we ask that you would hear our prayers. You alone have power to redeem your enemies and make them friends. In the mercy of Jesus, Lord, you've claimed us to be your own. Enable us to show that love to our enemies, which just seems just a tough word. But you've called us to love our enemies, to heap grace upon them. We ask that you would do that, even as we have received so much love that we never deserved from you. Help us to show our love to others. Lord, you delight in seeing your will and your works being done in this world today. And as you have set up in advance good works for us to do, we ask that we would do them, despite the evil that has fallen in this world. We ask that we would be about your mission to seek and save the lost. As we join you, Lord, we ask that we would make the gospel known among the nations, and that you would continue to bolster us, strengthen us, restore us, renew us, and lead us. Lord, we thank you for the life that we have, and we thank you for our St. Peter family. Continue to nurture and grow it. You are the Spirit of truth. And Lord, we thank you that when that Spirit comes upon us, we know what is good and right. I ask that you would work mightily among each and every one of us as we go about our vocations, both at home, at work, in society, and even here at church. Fill our hearts and minds with your wisdom so that we can tell others about the wisdom that we ourselves have received, as well as your grace. Father, we ask that you would be with those who are broken in heart, body, or mind today. Comfort the lonely and renew their spirits, especially those who are despairing. Be with those who are in need of clothing or shelter. Be with those who are walking through the desert of difficult times, and lead them to that oasis of living water. We ask that you would be with those who are in special need of healing, guidance, and strength. For Dawn, for Nathan's mom, for Paula, who's recovering from her back surgery, and for others that we name in our hearts now. Lord, your loving care is renewed each and every morning. We thank and praise you for that, for the blessing of family and friends, for birthdays and anniversaries, for celebrations of life. We thank you. We ask that you would remind us that we would be in a place that, in a sense, is a battleground, but you already have seen the victory. I pray for salvation and strength. I pray, Lord, that you would bless us as we prepare our hearts to receive what comes to us in bread and wine, the very body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus. We bow our heads before you, and we ask that you would heap upon us your grace, salvation, forgiveness of sins, and strength for our lives today. Even as we pray it as a family prayer, you also have taught us to pray. And so in keeping with that, we ask that you would hear us pray that same prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he gave thanks, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, also he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink it, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant, my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Known also as God's peace, may God's peace be with each and every one of you always. Amen. As you have prepared your hearts and minds, welcome to the Lord's table. Amen.
Thank you.
Father God, you are the source of all goodness, and in your perfect love, you sent your only begotten Son into the world to deliver us. And so we delight in that fact. And we delight in the fact that we have received now the wonderful body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. That joy is ours in Jesus, even amid all the difficulties of this world. We now have received forgiveness of sins, life, and salvation. And as we have received this, so may we give, extending others to others grace that you have given us. We pray this through Jesus Christ, he's your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God now and forever.
Amen.
Let your love be genuine. Turn from what is evil and hold fast to what is good.
Let us see one another as brothers and sisters in Christ.
Delight yourselves in the Lord, even when life is difficult. Hold fast to Jesus, rejoice in him.
Let us focus on evil with good, and go forth in Jesus' name.
Lord bless you and keep you. Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor, giving you his peace. Amen. Our last song is All God's People Said, and I think that last tune will be As We Leave.
Week of the Lord.